Ben voilà.
I'm a professional clapper. Brexit. Brexit was signed, well, was agreed, as we know, 4 years ago. And since then, we had two periods. We had the first period that was a transition period that started in January 2020 and finished on the 31st of January. So we had, for Brexit, we had three different periods. We had the vote and the negotiations of the trade and cooperation agreement. And then we had this transition period with a withdrawal agreement. And then as of the 1st of January, 9 months ago, we had the period where the UK is effectively out of the EU. So there are two documents that are of importance and that you should know, and for those who are interested, that you should read as well. It's the withdrawal agreement, which was signed in November 2019, and the Trade and Cooperation Agreement, the TCA, Trade and Cooperation Agreement, that was signed over Christmas last year in 2020. These two documents set out the rules that will apply to the relationship between the UK and the EU on two different issues. The goods, the merchandise, the canoes for our sector, the paddles, these sort of things, and the services, the delivery of service, taking a group of kayakists to the Ardèche or to Austria if you are from the UK. So as you can see, there is two sides. It's merchandise, goods, and service delivery. The goods. The goods is a very important issue for the UK because 13% of EU goods are brought into or were brought into the UK, and 50% of UK goods were brought into the EU. So the exchange of goods is of prime importance. And what the Brexit does is that the TCA has laid out a rule, and Boris was extremely pleased over Christmas that there is no tax. Okay, there is no tax on goods being imported from the UK into the EU. And he was very pleased that he didn't have to respect EU rules anymore. Yes, no more EU rules. However, the EU rules, or a copy-paste of the EU rules, have been introduced into the TCA, into the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. So the concept that the UK can export without paying tax is right, juridically right, providing they still respect not the EU rules anymore, the EU rules that have been changed into the TCA rules. So we are back to exactly square one. And of course, there is what is called the level playing field, which is a rule in the TCA, in the Trade and Cooperation Agreement, a rule that if the UK starts socially dumping its trade, or if they start exempting their organization of tax, or if they start paying grants to the trade, then there will be tax. So, in real terms, it's only tax-free because it's a copy-paste of what was done before. So it's no great success in real terms. It's just the same thing as before. But if the UK doesn't respect the rules, they will be taxed. And the tax may be done on... So that's the first aspect. The second aspect of goods is that the products that are exported or imported into the EU must be originated from the UK, which means that if the origin is not sufficient, then there is a tax. I take an example: a kayak is being constructed in China. They import it into the UK. They try to import it into the EU. the kayak will be taxed exactly as if it was coming from China direct. If the kayak is 100% made in the UK, then it's not taxed. But the trade and cooperation agreement goes further than that, because it says it's not just 100% built. If 20% of the kayak comes from China, or if 30% of the kayak comes from China, then there is a tax that grows accordingly. So it really asks for looking into details. If you do trade with the UK, you may continue to do so, but you must be aware of the exact origin of the products, and depending on the origin of the products, there will be or not a growing tax or not. The second aspect is that it may be tax-free on a principle, but it's not paperwork-free. So because custom has been reintroduced, and Great Britain being back to what it was 40 years ago, 1973, they joined the EU, so we are back to 1973. And because there is custom, it means that there is paperwork to be introduced with the transporters, with the customs, and of course, who talks about papers, talks about costs, about time, and where you used to have a kayak that was going from, I don't know, Manchester to Lyon within 24 hours, it may take 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, and of course, there is a cost to the operation. Now, the cost of the paperwork may sound ridiculously small, especially if you import 1,000 kayaks at the same time, because you fill in one set of forms, and the percentage cost is zero. But if you import one kayak, it's practically the same paperwork. And so the percentage cost is going to grow much higher. I was citing the example of a company that there was an article in one of the UK newspaper, and it's a fencing company. You know that they do things for how do you say in English fencing kits, you know, protection, and for the Olympic Games, you know, where they go with swords, and it's a family business, and they used to export their swords and their fences throughout the EU for Olympic teams of fencing or whatever, and their average package is 300 euros of orders. So if you put 30 euros worth of paperwork and custom costs, it's 10%, and 10% was their margin. They stopped selling in the EU. So I don't know the exact price of a kayak arriving from the UK. It's not the issue. The issue is for you, if you trade with the UK, is to be aware of these issues, because it will impact your business and your relationship. So do check. Of course, there are now side issues to this situation. Is the fact that because of Brexit, a lot of drivers, a lot of professionals have gone back home, and they are actually at the moment they are short with lorry drivers. So there is this issue that they are missing 100,000 lorry drivers. So out of 400,000, that's 25%. There are consequences, and we may not be finished with or be over with the consequences. That's for the goods. Now, let's talk about another aspect of the Brexit consequence, which is service delivery. I'm not going to teach you anything in saying that the Brits have always been great professionals in the outdoors. They produced good training, good equipment, good people in climbing, in kayaking, in sailing, in you name it. The Brits are pros in the outdoors. There is no debate about that. And of course, there are a lot of Brits who used to come to the continent, as they call it, or to the EU now, to deliver the service. Ski instructor, kayak guide, raft guide, in Greece, in France, in Italy, in everywhere. Hiking tours of the Mont Blanc for UK tourists. I mean, the biggest tour operators are in the UK. So service delivery is, of course, directly impacted by Brexit. Behind service delivery, there are two, it's a coin with two faces, with two sides. There is the side of work permit, and there is the side of qualification recognition, which are different. But in any case, you cannot come to the EU to work if you don't address these two aspects, work permit, recognition of qualification. For work permit, the trade and cooperation agreement sets rules. I'm going to try to make it simple. There are basically two big ways to exchange for Brits to work in the EU. I'm going to stand on the UK side. I'm a UK company, and I want my staff to go and work in France, in Italy, because I'm a tour operator, because I'm a rafting company, because whatever. Or I'm a self-employed. Okay, so company, self-employed. In both cases, for companies, the rules are quite heavy. You need to, the staff that you send to France or to Italy needs to have been employed for at least 1 year with the company. To have 3 years professional experience, 3 years in our job, it means 6 seasons, okay? And have a university degree. How many tour operators are going to be able to do that? It's going to be complicated. Now, if I'm a self-employed, I'm a kayak guide, and I want to take my clients to Switzerland, to France, or whatever. Of course, there is no more 1 year professional experience working for the company because I work for nobody. I'm by myself. But then it's not 3 years professional experience anymore. It's 6 years, 12 seasons. Because, you know, seasons are 4 months, 5 months at the best. 12 years. So if I'm 20 years old and I've got a BCU level, whatever, and I want to come, I've got to wait until I'm 32. That's going to be complicated. So that's the first possibilities that are laid out by the TCA. The second possibility is if I'm in France and I want to employ a UK guy through my company for my raft base, because I've got a raft base on the Durance or something, or as a temping agency, because temping agencies are dealt with differently. Now, these rules don't apply anymore. All I have to do is advertise the job for 3 weeks, and if, but then we've made tests. We had people responding. Still, the Ministry of Work allowed us, because we've made a test with the temping agency, and they get with mountain leaders, not with kayakers, but it's the same thing. And we had the go-ahead from the Ministry of Interior. Because, you see, politically, the two situations are very different. From the government point of view, when it's a British company or a self-employed who wants to come to Europe, it's competition for European companies. But when it's a French company who wants to employ a Brit, or a temping agency who wants to employ a Brit, it's perceived as being a company that is growing and needs a certain type of employees. And so they are more favorable this way than that way. So if you are in this sort of environment and business and you are interested in, I would make sure that you try to play that way more than this way. Does that make sense? That's the four possibilities. And there are lists, and to be honest, the outdoors is not on the list. So it means that there is no commitment. It doesn't mean that it's not allowed, but it means that there is no commitment between the UK and the EU. So it means that we will have to play with these four different possibilities, try to make our way through, make tests, and introduce dossiers. It's going to take a little while. But as you can see, it's not automatic. It's not here I go. I was called last week by a guy. Him and his wife, they deliver 2 weeks clients in Austria, 2 weeks in Italy, and 2 weeks in France every year. He's a ski instructor. Great. So I said, okay, you're going to have to introduce a work permit in Austria, and then a work permit for the 2 weeks in France, and the work permit for the 2 weeks in Italy. And he says, that's not going to be possible. And I said, well, sorry, mate, Brexit is Brexit. You need free work permits. Because being recognized in one member state, doesn't bind the other member state. If the Italians say, come and work for 2 weeks, the Italians say, come and work for 2 weeks. It doesn't mean that the Germans have to make you, or the Slovenians. No. Each member state is autonomous and on this issue. Of course, if you are, this also may apply, I mean, the directive, well, we'll talk about the directive afterwards. But this is very important that there is no open bar anymore, of course, that's gone, that's finished. Free movement of professionals is over. And so, you know, there are new rules. The second aspect, the other side of the coin, as I mentioned, is the recognition of qualification. As you may know, there are a lot of member states where the profession is regulated. Spain, Italy, France, whatever. In some member states, there is no regulation. So your grandmother can go and teach kayak in some countries, in others they can't. If the profession is regulated, it means that before you arrive, even if you've got a work permit, actually you will not get a work permit if you don't have your qualification recognized, you need to have your qualification recognized before you arrive in the member state. Before, we used to have the directive, and the system was reasonably simple in the fact that if you were a professional in your country, the host member state, the country of destination, must recognize you as a professional. And so when you declared to be recognized, it was not automatic, but if the host member state didn't agree, they had to demonstrate that your qualification was not good enough. Because the directive doesn't apply anymore, the new system is that you have to demonstrate them that your qualification is good enough. The charge of evidence has been inverted. And where you were innocent until proven guilty, you now have to prove your innocence, if I may use this comparison. How is it going to work? I've asked our partner lawyer, Philippe Planès. He's actually based in Lyon, but he couldn't make it today, so we recorded this 2 days ago. And we've been working with him as an organization. We've been working with him for now 20 years. And I think at the moment he's running something like 75, 80 court cases today. 80 court cases, administrative court cases against France to defend the interest of EU professionals. 80. So he knows a little bit about recognition of qualification. This is his comment on the recognition, the new system for recognition of qualification. Philippe.
En ce qui concerne, par contre, les nouveaux entrants, ceux qui feraient des demandes aujourd'hui, on est un peu dans le flou parce que, dans le flou, on n'est pas dans le flou, on va bien comprendre que les pays membres vont faire payer, soyons clairs, ils vont faire payer aux Britanniques leur sortie de l'Union européenne et donc ils vont tout faire pour leur mettre des bâtons dans les roues pour pouvoir exercer une activité en France. Ou, alors moi je parle de la France parce que c'est le pays que je connais, mais ne vous y trompez pas, quand vous irez en Allemagne, en Italie ou en Autriche, enfin où vous voulez faire vos activités de kayak, je pensais aux pays qui avaient un peu de montagne, vous verrez, ce sera très compliqué parce que le processus sera bien différent. Il n'y aura aucune automaticité. Vous n'avez aucun délai impératif de traitement de votre dossier. Donc, déjà que nous rencontrions des résistances administratives dans les pays de l'Union entre membres de l'Union européenne, je peux vous dire que là, les délais de traitement seront incommensurables. On vous demandera toujours des papiers complémentaires. On vous dira que vous ne prouvez pas. Alors là, c'est complètement différent puisqu'il va falloir prouver, il va falloir faire des démonstrations sur le contenu de votre diplôme. On vous demandera de les traduire. Enfin, on vous mettra tout ce qui est possible. Ce sera très, très compliqué. Et donc, je crains que les délais de traitement soient très longs, que les réponses soient négatives pour la plupart, qu'il faille ensuite engager des procédures dans le tribunal administratif, puisqu'en France, vous avez une juridiction spécialisée pour contester les décisions de l'État. Donc, ce sera long. Alors, si vous avez le même diplôme ou la même qualification que de personnes qui ont ces qualifications et qui ont vu la reconnaissance s'appliquer en France au préalable, on pourra se prévaloir sans doute de jurisprudence en disant si cette qualification, nonobstant, mais ce sera sur un autre terrain juridique, nonobstant le fait que je ne suis pas dans l'Union européenne, cette qualification a été validée par l'Union européenne. On ne pourra pas, par exemple, si on prend l'exemple de l'accord sur le CTT, anciennement MOU en ski, vous aviez une liste de qualifications qui était considérée comme d'exercer sur l'ensemble du territoire de l'Union européenne, une activité de moniteur de ski. Bon ben, si votre qualification figurait sur cette liste, vous pourrez quand même vous en prévaloir en disant mais l'analyse de l'équivalence a déjà été faite. Je vous démontre, c'est un élément probatoire, mais ce n'est plus un élément de droit automatique. Mais ça implique qu'il y aura une bagarre juridique pour pouvoir faire reconnaître ses droits, ce qui veut dire que pendant cette période-là, un certain nombre de Britanniques ne pourront pas intervenir sur le territoire de l'Union européenne, en tout cas pays par pays. Et surtout, ça implique qu'il faudra engager des procédures, ce qui a un coût nécessairement. Donc, la bataille ne fait que commencer. Et c'est très compliqué pour les Britanniques qui n'ont pas fait de déclaration avant le 31 décembre 2020. Alors, oui, tout à fait, Jean-Yves. La difficulté se rajoute parce que je rappelle que au sein de l'Union européenne, pour ce qui s'applique encore pour tous les États membres de l'Union européenne, la reconnaissance des qualifications, bien qu'elle soit facilitée par les directives, se fait déjà pays par pays. C'est-à-dire que si vous avez une qualification qui est reconnue en France, elle n'est pas automatiquement reconnue en Italie, sauf, je vous donnais l'exemple du CTT, anciennement OU dans le ski, qui prévoyait un accord, et c'est un accord supranational et multilatéral, qui permet de faciliter la reconnaissance dans l'ensemble des pays de l'Union européenne. Mais déjà préalablement, quand vous ne bénéficiez pas de cet accord multilatéral, votre reconnaissance en France ne permettait pas automatiquement d'aller travailler en Italie ou en Autriche, par exemple. Donc, il fallait quand même recommencer une démarche de déclaration. Évidemment, en principe, lorsque vous avez été reconnu par une administration membre de l'Union européenne, c'est plus facile de se faire reconnaître par une autre administration. Ça, c'est la théorie. Mais ça, c'était avant. En ce qui concerne la situation des qualifications et des ressortissants britanniques aujourd'hui, la difficulté, c'est que toutes les démarches devront être recommencées depuis le départ, pays par pays. C'est-à-dire que à chaque fois que vous voulez intervenir dans un pays, il va falloir faire une demande d'équivalence. Alors, ça va se compliquer en plus parce que non seulement c'est une demande d'équivalence, mais ensuite, il y a un système d'autorisation de travail, c'est-à-dire qu'il va falloir se déclarer non plus simplement dans son domaine d'activité, mais également d'une manière plus générale. Alors, en France,
so then he goes back, of course, on the first aspect, the work permit, but we've already discussed this. So as you can see, service delivery for Brits between the work permit and the recognition of qualification. Sorry. So as you can see, there is goods on the one side, services on the other side, and the situation is somewhat very different to what it used to be. Maybe you've got questions or you want precisions or something about one aspect or the other. I remain available for you guys. Otherwise, well, tomorrow we will be welcoming people here at 10 o'clock. And we will have a discussion about the possible future of the outdoors in general and kayak and water activities in particular. So you are welcome to join us tomorrow at 10 o'clock. Until then, have a lovely show. Goodbye. Thank you very much.